Well, thank you, everybody, for coming back here. I just want to a couple of quick comments on the agenda for this afternoon. We have had two requests for the last slot, which was an open discussion. One of them was specifically a couple of the community members requested time to discuss some of the topics that are on the day two and day three of this meeting. In other words, the MAG meeting itself. And I mean, I think that's only appropriate that if there are topics that are of interest to the community members from the MAG meeting, which will kick off tomorrow morning, that we give some floor time to that. So we will try and maintain the overall timing of the schedule here. And then there was also a request for a very brief presentation on some work Miguel and the working group has been doing on new formats. And I think that would be helpful in terms of just getting people to think about it a little bit. Think about it overnight. We can talk about it a little bit more before we go into the broader workshop discussion tomorrow. So we have those two items on that that final slot. So with that, I will turn the floor over in just a moment to Wyman Kwok from UNDESA. He's going to just introduce the retreat. I think a lot of information has been shared already. He's not intending to do a full or comprehensive presentation, but a short retreat, and then we would open it up to comments from the floor. And in this session, we clearly want to hear from community members. We also obviously need to hear from the MAG members as well, so it'll be a slightly different session than what we might normally do in terms of prioritizing speakers in the open consultation day. So with that, I'll give the floor to Wyman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Let me just start with what Mr. Wu, Undersecretary General for DESA, mentioned this morning. This retreat is really part of an ongoing process. That really is as what you know, IGF has a past 10 years of IGF history. But looking forward, there's this renewal of 10 years is an opportunity for the community as a whole to see how we can advance not just on a more ad hoc or yearly affair, but what is the longer term strategy to guide us through that. First is that for DESA, I think we are convening this on behalf of the Secretary General. One is that is actually, other than the tourist outcome, is also related very much to the development agenda of DESA itself. But then again, IGF is a very unique platform. It is unlike other platforms, the UN, as you know, we have several platforms. Being IGF being that unique, that means we really have to count on the community to give us the advice. The retreat is really a brainstorming session. We are actually looking at participants with rich experience, with diverse expertise, some of whom have contributed a lot, some of whom have good knowledge. As you know, Mr. Nitin Desai will be joining us, at least in the beginning of the retreat. We also have, other than Lynn herself, we have our former chair of MAC, including Marcus himself, Yanis. We are also getting Mr. Peter Major, who is the CSTD chair and who is also the chair of the working group on improvement to the IGF. And a lot of you know that the retreat participants, in any case, they are all published in the website, IGF website. And along with that is also all the documents there. While there are different consideration, constraints, being the retreat, the objective like to tap on more of a holistic strategy discussion among individuals who have that expertise, but how to actually come up with refreshing idea, and also it's not just one idea. It can be different ideas. It can be polarized ideas. It can be opposing views. But to pull together, that will go to kind of the what initially we term as outcome, but now we actually we correct our text because outcome, I think it also leads to different interpretation. So end of the retreat, there will be a set of ideas, a set of suggestions, probably in one document or single document. There's actually more of the formatting. But in any case, that will be going back to the community. as we have several discussions with some of you, including with Lynn as the chair, it could be a working document, it could be a it could serve as a ongoing work in progress to guide the work of different work streams, including whether it's the MAC or in the IGF Secretariat itself, or the different initiatives coming from IGF. The one last thing that I want to mention is that there is actually this open process, and the inclusive process of IGF is something that we would like to continue to uphold. So as you know, starting from the agenda, the call for participations, right, and also the call for inputs. At this moment, we receive a total of 28 inputs. They are all online. And part of the discussion, in the discussion, any documents coming out, you will also be published online as soon as they are ready. We have to continue to listen to all the stakeholders, including yourself, the wider community, on how we can actually improve not just the retreats, the modality, but also the entire IGF process itself. So thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Wyman. And there are no other comments from Changatai. I don't know that I have anything to add to that specifically, so I think we'll just open the floor for questions. And I want to check and see if we have the online participation sorted out. No?
No.
But are they able to hear us, or are they just reading from the transcript?
I think they're able to hear us through webcast.
Okay. Yeah, well, I do hope we get that sorted out soon. So in the queue, I have Mike 166, Chip Sharp. Okay, I'm going to remember you as you have the floor, Chip.
Thank you very much, and I appreciate the opportunity to comment on the retreat. I guess a couple of questions. I'm not still not really clear on terms of the retreat. Is it sounds like there's going to be some output from this retreat. I guess there should be, since there wouldn't be a point of having a retreat if there's not some output. But my question is, who is that output going to, and what are they going to do with it? What's going to be made? What is this going to be made use of? Thank you.
What I mentioned just now, the outputs right now, it will be a list of ideas and suggestions, and there could be different documents of the five identified sessions following the agenda, and this will be put online for consultation with the different stakeholder groups, including the MAC itself. So there is actually no decisions. And it will not even be mentioned as recommendations, but it's a list of ideas and suggestions to see how we can actually put forward for consideration. One example is the NRI. How the whole community, including the IGF Secretariat, should do to support the NRI. So there could be a list of ideas. As I mentioned, it's brainstorming. So there could be many ideas. Some of this will be related to funds, some will be related to communication outreach. So that can be work on different work streams, including by the current initiative by the MAC and also the various NRI focal point. They could actually take that further for future action.
If I could, thank you, Wyman. We'd actually like to hear from people here in terms of what would work. Obviously, there have been smaller discussions and smaller group meetings and people sending in suggestions. One of the suggestions we looked at was to do something similar to the WISIS plus 10 output paper from last year's IGF, which had a series of guiding questions as input to the discussion. The discussion was held. It was very open, very multi-stakeholder. We had four microphone cues around the room. And the paper that was submitted afterwards, which is part of the IGF record, basically said there was a discussion around topic X, a little bit of kind of context or background, and then tried to represent, and I was the one who wrote the bulk of it, but tried to represent, you know, there was significant agreement on X with some dissenting opinions on Y, or Y was proposed, but there was no clear consensus, and a couple of other alternatives were suggested. So it was a factual report out which tried to sort of assess for everybody else in the round what sort of support there was or wasn't for the various points that came up in the meeting. So one suggestion is we do something like that, probably organized around the five main sessions, and then we put the document up for public comment, possibly using the same platform, the same tool that in fact was used for the Connecting the Next Billions Phase One pilot, which allows for very interactive editing. And in fact, I think that was the same platform that was used for the Net Mundial input document or paper. But again, you know, we're really looking for the conversation today and the next couple of days to help clarify what would be helpful if people know of better practices, better processes, or better tools. You know, I think everybody would absolutely like to hear them. And then, of course, we would need to get the support of the participants in the retreat on the day as well. So I throw that out there, but we're really looking to hear from, you know, what, assuming that everybody wants the IGF to be as, you know, successful and have as much impact as possible, and that this retreat is the start of a journey, which is really looking to start a discussion at quite a high level, brainstorming, that we can take out to the community and communities, what would make that most helpful, assuming, again, we all share the objective of looking to advance the IGF and have as much impact as possible from the work we all do. So with that, I'll open the queue. If people could please use their mic. You have your hand up in the back, but if you could use the technology in front of us as well, that would be helpful. And please introduce yourself.
Right. Thank you. Richard Jordan from the Royal Academy of Science International Trust. I think one use of any group of ideas should all go to whoever the new Secretary General will be. I think many of them have stressed the desire to reach out to different audiences, to reach out to youth, to engage business and industry, and I think whoever it is should benefit perhaps from ideas, and that could be one purpose of whatever is produced, whether they're just ideas or later recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you. Michael Nelson, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chairman. Mike Nelson with Cloudflare, a web security company. As you work through the issues at the retreat, I hope that a lot of time will be spent on what I consider a pretty serious problem, which is that we are losing some of our stakeholders at the IGF. When we heard the report first thing this morning about where the proposals came from, I think we heard that only about 10% of the proposals came from the private sector. And if you look at what's been happening over the last 5 years, we really have seen fewer and fewer people from the private sector who are making some very important decisions about internet governance. So I think we have to face up to that. And one way to face up to that is to realize that the private sector tends to go to meetings where there's a lot of attention paid to what goes on. To be crass, many companies go where the reporters are and where there's news reports about what's going on. We have an incredibly rich amount of content coming out of IGF meetings, and yet the press is not showing up. They're not talking to some of the best people grappling with the issues that will define what happens to the internet over the next 5 years. It would be a pity if at Guadalajara we didn't have dozens of mainstream media reporters, some with news cameras. We'll have a few bloggers, but if the past is prologue, we're not going to get as much attention as we need. One thing that we might think about doing, and this is a result of a conversation I had with Peter Dengate Thrush over lunch, is we should think about doing some warm-up webinars prior to the main event. Tim O'Reilly does a very successful conference called Strata. It's about big data. And in the 6 to 8 weeks before the conference, he does a weekly webinar with some of the best panelists talking about the most exciting topics. And it's just an hour, hour and a half. And it's a way to build momentum, get people excited about the new topics, and also a way to pull reporters into the discussion. Some of the reporters won't bother to come to Guadalajara, but at least they'll tune in and they'll tell the world what's going on. And that, I think, will have a very positive feedback and get governments to pay more attention, get private sector to pay more attention, and help us restore the balance between the different stakeholder groups that we want to reach at the IGF. I just think we need to do more to reach those communities which have not been coming as often as they used to. So thank you very much, and I look forward to the results of the retreat. It's a great group of people spending 2 days on a very important mission.
Thank you, Michael. Council of Europe, Christina, you have the... Oh, Lee.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I really want us just... Lee Hibbard from the Council of Europe, and I've been Internet Governance Coordinator for many years in the IGF since its inception. And I've been to many MAG meetings, and I've been to pretty much all the IGFs except for Hyderabad. And the Council of Europe is very supportive, of course, since the outset, and has brought expertise into this process and has taken very good ideas away and then turned them into public policy instruments in the Council of Europe sphere of its 47 member states, dealing with the human rights, rule of law, and democracy online. So it's been very useful for us over the years. And I think we have to reflect on the different actors and what it means for them. But the biggest question and the most important is to say, what does success look like? I'd like to know more from the room and from out on remote. What does it look like? What does it look like for NRIs? What does success look like for them? They're doing the same thing at the national and regional level. Are they successful? How do they see that? I was very struck by the Undersecretary General from UN Desert this morning, who said, very, very eloquently, it's a lot about SDG implementation. So I think one has to be there's a need to maybe be more narrow, rather than too broad sometimes in the actual what the success looks like, and he said very well, I think, the question of where are we close? Where can we achieve where can we achieve wins? Where are we close in terms of positions? And linkages and synergies, he mentioned, which is very important. Are we linked? Are we in synergy where we can be? The Internet Governance Strategy of the Council of Europe for the next 4 years, 2016-2019, has a number of actors in which we will try to link up with others to work out responses to issues like law enforcement issues, jurisdiction issues, etc. Are we writing that down? Are we actually saying we need to get X and Y together in the same room and have that conversation? So the question is, who are we serving? What public policy are we referring to? I know I'm asking too many questions and not giving enough answers, but do we need some wins? I think we need some certain wins where we have proximity. And a lot has been mentioned time and time again. I want to reassert that. The issue of, the question of journalists is very important. The question of visibility, of course, is always very important. But outreach and capacity building, are we doing enough capacity building? Are we creating enough capacity building programs? We talk about young people, but are enough young people coming? What can we do to really maximize global young people coming or talking about internet governance? And the same thing goes for human rights. Always, there's always a very big push for human rights every year. Are we doing enough on that score? So, what does success look like? It will look different for different actors, different stakeholders. But there must be something in the middle of all of those which brings us together and where we can have some wins. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee. I think there were some good questions there. And we've got three more people in the queue, but maybe we could ask people to either, if a question, which is what does success look like for you, work for you would be helpful. If you have some concrete examples of the, you know, the way you think we can engage the community after the retreat, in other words, saying that is what might some useful outputs look like, what form might they take? Those are things which would really be helpful and certainly good input to the retreat. You had a lot of good questions there as well. Next on the list, we have ICANN, which I assume is Nigel. So ICANN is the next in the queue.
Ah, yes. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Thank you, Madam Chair. And it's a great opportunity to comment on this retreat. You asked the question, "What does success look like?" Or the question was asked, and I think that's very important indeed. I think it's important not so much on the retreat, although it's clearly important that the retreat is a success. But what I would suggest is critically important is that the retreat contributes to the overall success of the IGF itself. And I think we're at a very important juncture. I mean, clearly, this time last year we were in the run up to the WSIS Plus 10 review and all the importance of that in terms of the future of internet governance. But the way that the IGF develops and matures over the next 9 to 10 years, I think, is going to be equally important in setting the overall agenda for internet governance. And so for the retreat, I would like to draw on just three elements, really, that have been covered in the various submissions that have been made. And it's really good news, as UNDESA noted, that you had 28 contributions for this retreat, and that's clearly significant. So the first point is the document to be produced or whatever, and very much in favour. I think it's an excellent initiative to have a living document, to have something that comes out of the retreat that can be presented to the MAG, and just as importantly, can be presented to the IGF in Guadalajara as something that's living, not a static document that makes 5 recommendations and that's that, has dates and codes or whatever, but some real ideas behind a living document that people can contribute to and can take it forward. So I think that's really, really important. I think the second point is the role and composition of the MAG itself and what the MAG does. This is a tremendous opportunity. As someone said in their contributions to the retreat, and I won't name names because I've forgotten who wrote it, but I someone said to the effect that this is a very expensive program committee, the MAG. This is a tremendous group of talent in this room, and I'm not in the MAG, so I can say that freely. And surely the talent and the experience of this group of people could be used not only to shape the program, which it does in such an excellent way in terms of opining on the workshops and the forums and that, but also could look at the whole structure of how the IGF goes forward, as I'm sure it will in the future. And one of those ideas, and this third point coming out of the retreat, was in the submission from the UK government, from Mark Carvel, on the nature of this idea of policy initiatives. Now, this isn't new as such, but I think Mark put it in a very eloquent way in his submission. In other words, this ability of having some form of discussions at the IGF on certain policy ideas. So you don't just discuss the broader issues, but you also discuss a question, if you like, that the international community has. We often talk about the IGF, and I often talk about the IGF, as being the ideal forum for putting ideas into people's heads that can then go to the policy forums, whether they be OECD or ICANN or some other some other policy forum, and input into that policy forum in the knowledge and in the experience of what happened at the IGF. But there's also another way round, in that we use the IGF as a testbed, as an arena in which to evaluate some of these policy ideas. So we come to the IGF and we say ICANN is thinking of doing X or Y, or the ITU is thinking of doing this, or the OECD is thinking of doing this. What does the IGF think? What does the broader community think? Because the IGF is such a broader community than we have in some of our own organizations. So I think that's a really excellent idea and something that could be taken forward. So I'll finish there. I wish the retreat every success, and I'm sure it will be an excellent occasion for this genesis of a new 9-year strategic think, so to speak. It's dreadful English, I know, but there you are. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nigel. Next in the queue is Ritu Sharma. You have the floor.
Good afternoon. Thank you again for the opportunity. And I'd like to share some thoughts from my experience of organizing about 100 conferences in 14 cities in the last 4 years in four countries. I think one I would say is potentially looking at feeder events into different regions where your stakeholders are speaking, and adding to what Mike Nelson said. When I go into Silicon Valley, where I'm based out of, and I speak with my corporate partners and such, very few people know the ITU, the IGF, except for the really a handful of policy folks. So potentially hosting some conversations, even if it's an annual a simple breakfast forum or something, in some of these technology hubs where the technology community is present, where you go where some of the stakeholders are, would be a good way to engage with them, also to increase your visibility. Second, I'd like to say is really thinking about during your retreat about what you can do to be systematically inclusive of younger people and women in a way that's not very cumbersome to engage. And an example would be I congratulate you on all the efforts you've made in the comprehensive application for speaking slots at the IGF, where you've given a number of criteria to make sure that everybody is represented, but it's also quite cumbersome. So thinking about some ways that you can make that process either easier, or perhaps having a sidetrack for first-time speakers, younger speakers, women, to potentially give you ideas about if you're interested in speaking, but you don't have either the experience or the roster to come up with speakers from 5 different constituencies. Many of us don't have that, so we are really prohibited and discouraged from applying. And I really tried to get help to get a proposal in a time, but to know a business person, a policy person from different sectors, from different genders, it was very, very difficult for me, and I was discouraged. So I would say not to lower your standard in the work that you've already done in being inclusive, but I think creating a forum, as I said early in the morning, but to kind of really build on that during your retreat, to think about what can you do to create a forum for people who are first-timers, who are not connected across domains. Those are your new and fresh voices. What can you do to give them a central place to say, hey, anybody who wants to participate but doesn't have the expertise or the know-how to know all these things, you can congregate here and our staff person will help you figure out where we can put you all together or figure out some similar mechanism. And then finally, I think looking at embracing technology a little bit, given that we are Internet Governance Forum, we at the Social Media for Nonprofits, our program, where we've served over 10,000 people in 4 countries, we've used internet platforms, whether it's Periscope, whether it's Twitter, whether it's Facebook Live, you name it, almost every one of them. So I think using a combination of social media a little bit more effectively to engage people who are not here and maintaining that visibility and branding, and potentially having a live Twitter feed, live feed besides the webcast feed, would help you engage around hashtags and be up and about on technology without favoring one provider or the other. Would be some simple suggestions for you to consider during your retreat. Thank you very much for the opportunity to comment, and I hope some of it is helpful.
Yeah, thank you, Rudos. It's very, very helpful comments. Izumi Akitani, you have the floor.
Tom, Mike, has mentioned about the need for raising profile for the IGF. And I think what is needed is to extract what's relevant per stakeholder group. So going back to my community, I give update of the IGF and try to raise awareness. But I'm from the technical community, so I can share what's relevant for the technical community, but coverage from other stakeholders' perspective is weak. For example, I still have challenges in raising awareness and having more contributions from business. So having support from either the IGF secretariat or have like a common joint effort as the MAG on what's relevant from each stakeholder's perspective for this year's IGF would be really helpful. And outreaching to the media, just to give an example, that's separate from the IGF, we tried a media outreach event on the IANA stewardship transition and focusing on messaging towards the media. And that really worked for our coverage in the Japanese media. So just to share an example of what kind of work, so we might be able to consider something like that for the IGF. I also want to mention that it's not just for the media or the publicity or per stakeholders, but reaching out to the national and regional IGFs are very important. So very glad that this focused agenda on this topic. And I also would like to emphasize that this existing group on the national regional IGFs are helpful. And in addition to what's already being done, I think, again, having like highlights of what's like important for this year, what are the features for this year, is really helpful. I happen to be on the MAG until this year, so I can do that for APR IGF or the National IGF in Japan. But after this, I would not be able to share this. So if there is such opportunity that maybe non-MAG members can also participate, but from the national and regional IGF, like a webinar or something like that, then they can actually go back to their communities and make sure that people are up to date so that you can sync up in their program on what's relevant in terms of themes or like making sure that workshop is submitted from their respective communities. So those are my suggestions. Thank you.
Thank you, Izumi. Michael, were you in the queue again?
Yes. Thank you. Yes, Mike Nelson with Cloudflare again. I just had 40 seconds. In response to Lee's very good question, which is what does success look like, I wanted to propose two tweets, since I'm real fond of tweets, two ways to summarize what I would like to see the IGF really accomplish. The first tweet is what I would like to see as Cloudflare, which is I would like to see IGF provide the place where the very best people are talking about the most important internet issues in a way that will inform the debates happening in national governments, in courts, and in boardrooms. And then hashtag best practices forum, because I think that's one of the most important ways in which we can have an impact on all those debates. The second thing I would say, as a part-time professor at Georgetown who teaches internet studies, I would like to see the IGF be the TED Talks of internet, so that these incredible sessions we have, which are webcast and which are available on the Friends of IGF website, would be accessed not by a few hundred people or 1,000 people, but by literally 50,000 people. Because in many cases, what happened in Jao Pessoa or will happen in Guadalajara will be some of the best discussions on these topics with many of the right people, and we just have to get that those resources out to more people. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. We have Hanan Boujemi. You have the floor.
Hi, my name is Hanan Boujemi, and I'm senior manager with HIVOS IG programs. Regarding Lee's question about what success looks like, I'd just like to share an experience of a program that I'm managing at the moment with HIVOS. It's called IG MENA, and we're trying to engage civil society actors from the Middle East in the dialogue in internet governance. And I think from 4 years working on this program, what I learned is that continuous support to voices who do not have necessarily the space, the means, or the knowledge to be integrated in this field in general. And I think the IGF can probably learn from this experience by trying to work with communities on a continuous basis rather than just organizing webinars or, let's say, advocacy meetings around the forum itself. So I think, in my opinion, capacity building does not stop at a specific point, but it's a continuous work. And I suggest that we actually take the support from national and regional IGFs by maybe organizing focus groups of people who are willing to work at the local level and regional level with the wider participants. Because the more we have a centralized structure to work with communities or to engage with people, the more challenging it is. So we need to scale the work and, you know, divide it among different, you know, parties or organizations active in this field. I think it's also important to give the lead to people at the grassroots level, because they are facing different issues that we're maybe not aware of here at this level. And due to several challenges, they're not able to make it here to the room. So I think we probably should think how we can reach out to these communities at their level, at the local level and the regional level, and help transmit their messages to this fora. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We now have participant number 149. I guess look at your mics and see if your mic turns right. Deborah. Okay, great.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Deborah Brown. I'm from APC. Thanks very much for the opportunity to comment here. I want to go back to the modalities of the retreat itself. It's really great to hear that the outcomes of the retreat will be brought back to the community for input and for comment. I do have a question, though, on what happens with these outputs next. What are the roles and responsibilities for bringing them forward? The reason I ask is because it's important that there's accountability so that whatever outcome this process leads to the strengthening of the IGF, and that the broader IGF community has an opportunity to contribute to this. And I agree with some points that were raised earlier that this can be an evolving process rather than a static one, but there still needs to be clarity on who's carrying the outcomes forward, and that otherwise there's risk that this joint effort won't lead to the common goal of strengthening the IGF. One suggestion that APC included in our contribution to the IGF retreat inputs was that a smaller advisory group can be established with no more than 12 people that can work with senior secretariat staff, with UNDESA personnel, and can include MAG members, which can be identified through a NAMCOM process, and that this group can help implement the outcomes of the retreat process. And just another point on the retreat itself is I just wanted to underscore the importance of these discussions to be open and support some level of remote participation as much as is possible. There's been some suggestions of maybe a one hour a day of remote participation, or allowing participants to tweet using Chatham House rules and posting the summaries from one day to the next. So I wanted to just highlight those recommendations that APC and others have put forward. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Deborah. Just, are there any comments that either Wai Min or Changatai would like to make to that? Or, sorry, I didn't know you were conferring. If pass for now.
Yeah, okay, we can pass for now. I mean, it's just the comments that we've made for remote participation.
So go ahead.
We have.
Right.
Oh, no, just to answer Deborah's question, that we've had a lot of discussion about this remote participation within the group of participants as well, and it was felt that because we operate on a consensus mode, right? So, and there was a wide-ranging views on that, but it was felt that by some participants that remote participation and would distract from the purpose of the meeting, and it is a retreat. So if it's a retreat, it should behave like a retreat where people go away in a secluded place and discuss. But we are also going to publish some daily updates on what has been going on in that retreat. And we still have the open question on whether or not the actual participants can tweet, but we are going to finalize that on the first day of the retreat. But we are looking into that, and we take your concerns seriously.
Yeah. Thank you, Changitai. Sheeta, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Can you hear me? Okay. Sita Laksmi from Civil Society. To share with you that Indonesia is drafting the input for the retreat via multi-stakeholder processes. So we do it via email, we do it via discussing directly, and at the end of the day, we do it via Google Docs together. I was observing how the process was done, and one highlight was that there is an urgent need to make IGF more relevant to the real process on the ground. What's in it for me was the main questions that we had. I agree with the representative from the EU Council, perhaps to make the recommendation from the retreat to be more narrow and tangible for community, also echoing what the Izumi has mentioned. I really hope that the retreat can give recommendations we can then help IGF processes contribute to the more relevant issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheeta. Marilyn Cade, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Marilyn Cade speaking. I'm just going to make two comments reflecting comments that have come up in discussions and conference calls with the NRIs, and ask that this be taken into account. There's a section in the questions which refers to the NRIs, but very few of the NRIs themselves have been able to spend time on submitting responses. That may be because Anya and I are keeping them too busy working on their main session. But I think it's particularly important that any discussions about the NRIs not be taken in real time, even if there are two or three or four there. This is something they're committed to discussing in their calls and to providing further comments on, and I'd like to be sure that that is respected, while any ideas that are put forward by others about the roles that NRI should play or how further support could be provided would be, I think, also very welcomed by them. So that's my main point. My second point is, on the one hand, I hear reflection that this is a brainstorming session and everything will come back to the community. And then I hear about ideas that might even go into the project document. I hope, I liked the idea that you had mentioned, Chair, of perhaps using something of the format that we used in the WSIS Plus 10 consultation, because I think that's a very open, inclusive, and with time limits to speaking, that also means that you'll be able to take input from all of the participants on a rotating basis. Perhaps even if you can't support remote participation, and it's probably too late for you to support the transcript approach, it would be good if you can be as detailed as possible. And I think the suggestion that you made on how the report from the WSIS Plus 10 was done might be a very effective way to provide that documentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Marilyn. Just for the very first point you raised, I don't think there's any intent from anybody that I've spoken to about the retreat about sort of committing or making assumptions on behalf of what is either good for the NRIs, would work for the NRIs, or certainly committing any resources from them. That will obviously be a very robust consultation back with that community. So I just want to make sure that that point was clear. There are quite a few people in the queue, so we'll just keep going through and then maybe see if we can get to a couple of other wrap-up topics towards the end there. So I have United Kingdom, Mark Carvel. United Kingdom should have the floor, please. Waiting for the mic to turn. There you go.
Okay. Yep. I'm on. Thank you. Thank you, Lynn. Thank you, Chair. Good afternoon, everybody. A lot of very interesting points and suggestions have been tabled, and the United Kingdom government's very supportive of the retreat as an opportunity following the WSIS Plus 10 review to look at the IGF. And do some really long-term forward thinking for the next 10 years. Obviously, things can change during that 10-year period, so it shouldn't be too prescriptive. So our expectation is for the retreat to do some rethink of some key elements of the process that will address some of the deficiencies that have become apparent, and Mike Nelson flagged up a very important trend, if that's the right word, that seems to have developed in recent years of a fall off in private sector involvement in terms of submission of workshop proposals, and perhaps that is reflected in some of the active participation from the private sector. And there are other problems as well. I mean, I'm from a UK government ministry, but I don't see that many government officials actively participating. Not many governments submit workshop proposals. There must be reasons for that, which the retreat can very usefully address in a very timely fashion. And perhaps one of the conditions that we're currently experiencing is that post-WSIS plus 10 is maybe an element of complacency, and we need to be shaken out of that. So in terms of success and what kind of measures might we look to following the retreat and the process that the retreat might set in an ongoing way, if that is indeed the plan. Firstly, well, hopefully we will see countries queuing up to host the IGF. We don't really have that assurance at the moment in terms of who's going to host the IGF over the immediate future, even, which is quite worrying. So success in terms of countries saying, yes, they want to be part of the IGF action, actually want to host it, and their stakeholder communities all coming together in that particular country saying, yes, this is the time for us to do that. Secondly, success in terms of some real understanding of how the intersessional work is developing, how it's evolving, how it's meeting needs and expectations, and measures of how actually the experience of the last 2 years of intersessional work is showing results. We don't really have that assurance yet that the best practice fora and the policy options document, which are incredibly valuable, we don't have that assurance that they've got high visibility and they are being factored into public and private sector policy making processes. So success in terms of looking at how to advance the intersessional tangible outcomes. Thirdly, young people involvement. Yes, this is very important, but there are problems. We would like to see young people involved in as many sessions as possible, rather than saying, here's a dedicated main session for young people. That's not the approach, I think, which they would like. They want to be involved and participate. But how do you get that level of participation when it means travel over possibly long distances, except for obviously the young people in the country of which is hosting the IGF? So that brings you to the question of getting the level of effective remote participation up to the same standard as physical participation. Now, fourth measure of success is restoring the diversity of issues and levels of participation. And what I said in my contribution, my written contribution to the retreat, was that maybe a process in which complements the bottom-up workshop call for setting the program, a complementary process would be to solicit proposals for policy questions, which ICANN touched upon when they spoke earlier. This, I think, will provide a channel for engaging with the private sector, with governments, and with other constituencies with an interest in the internet, including users, business users, the ordinary citizens, through the soliciting of policy questions to the kinds of entities who have outreach to those communities, be they the national and regional IGFs themselves, be they the intergovernmental organizations, which may have business committees and so on. I'm thinking, for example, of the OECD, and ICANN, which has governmental advisory committee, a technical committee, a users advisory committee, ALAC. So you've got some important networks that you could use in order to solicit proposals for policy questions, and then that will promote awareness of what the IGF could do for those communities and actually attract them into participating actively, either physically in person or through remote participation. So that was one of the objectives that I had in mind for the policy question, looking at how policy questions can get those communities that are either drifting away or who are not aware of what the IGF has to offer in terms of opportunity and where success can be generated. Thanks.
Thank you, Mark. I just want to make one sort of quick comment here, I think, in that there's obviously not a lot of interaction back and forth. The retreat is called BIDESA. It's a retreat of all the stakeholder communities that are there. And I think all of us here and everybody here in the community is really listening to all of these inputs, and we should, absorb them all. I would ask actually if the Secretariat could perhaps, from the transcript, get to a sort of summary of comments as well that at the end of the day are actually given to all of the retreat participants, and we can post that online as well. So I just wanted to explain that we're all listening very carefully. We're taking notes. I think it would be a good idea to provide a summary of the comments which feed into the retreat participants and are posted here so that people really recognize that the comments were understood and are being pulled into the retreat as well. So with that, I have quite a long queue in front of me. Obviously, the shorter the interventions are, the more people we will get to hear from. So if you're in the queue already, if you could make your interventions quite to the point. Right now, since a few more have come in, the last one that I will recognize here at this point in time is Chip Sharp. He's not next. He's at the very end of the queue. And when we get to that end, if in fact there's still time left in this session, we can open it back up. But I don't want to mislead anybody with respect to their time to speak here at this point. So, Marilia, you have the floor. Could somebody please turn Marilia's mic on?
It's on. Thank you, Lynn. This is Marilia Maciel speaking on my personal capacity. I actually find the question about the future and what we expect very interesting, but I also think that at this moment it would be useful to look into the past. And this is not the first time that we are discussing IGF improvements. We have a recent experience about that. CSCD created a working group on IGF improvements. I had the opportunity to be part of it with some of the people that are here in the room, Marilyn, Constance, and others, and we produced a report. I think that this report talks about the same points, or almost the same points that we'll be discussing in the retreat, and some progress was made there in some of the points, such as making the IGF much more output-oriented. Good steps were made there. But I think that there are gaps or things that we could have advanced more, such as, for instance, funding the IGF or have transparency and accountability when it comes to IGF funding, transparency and accountability in the process of selecting MAG members, more opportunities for including less developed regions. I do agree with concerns with regards to private sector participation, but I think that the point that the report does in terms of including less developed regions of the world is also true today. But looking at the report, I think that it was a very interesting exercise in which we have five members from different stakeholder groups. We had the opportunity to meet six, seven times in Geneva, and it's something very concrete. And I think that one thing missed from this report, which is implementation. Afterwards, we have a good document, but we did not have a follow-up to that document. That's why I think that there is this uneven level of implementation in different recommendations that were made. So I do agree with the suggestion made by Deborah that needs to be a strategy for follow-up. And although it's a very good and interesting idea to have the document posted online for comments and treat it as a living document because we are improving every day, it's also very important to have a stable document that we can implement and establish milestones and to see when they're going to be achieved. So looking back at the previous experience, it was a rich one, but implementation was missing, and I think we should include that. If I can make just a small contribution in terms of future and where I think IGF could develop towards, I think that in the last years we have seen an inflation of different platforms, commissions, initiatives to discuss internet governance. I don't think this is necessarily bad, and some of them are taking points in the agenda of the IGF and diving deep in these points, and this is something that the IGF maybe it's not the best space to do. So I think that they are useful. And even if we believe that they are not useful, they are there to stay. It's very hard to turn back on that. So if these platforms are going to increase in number, how the IGF can have an interplay with them? In my view, the IGF could be a platform of platforms, a meeting point in which these different exercises and commissions, they come together and they talk to one another. So if there is a point that could be maybe explored in the retreat, I think that this would be a useful one. How the IGF can be a useful space in which these different initiatives, commissions, platforms come together and talk to one another about the development and the progress that they are making. Thank you.
Thank you, Marilia. Some very, very interesting comments. Next in the queue is Laurie Schulman.
Hello. I support what Marilia said about implementation and outcomes. I think that's critical. What I would see, what does success look like? I'm new to this process. My organization is new to this process. We do represent the private sector, so I think that's important to know that there are people coming to the table. Our membership comprises 6,700 organizations that are devoted to brand protection. Of these organizations, they include major corporations, small businesses, emerging businesses, nonprofits, as well as academics. So we are a microcosm of the community, but with a specific interest. I feel it's important to explain that here today so that you do know there are new interested members from the private sector who are ready to dig in and help with the hard work ahead. That being said specifically, I think it's important that whatever comes of this retreat, that the participants look to achieving a well-defined communications plan. And I don't necessarily mean for the retreat alone. I would look to how to plan, create a template for communicating results, whatever the results are, even if they're inconclusive. And that this plan be a format for reporting after the retreat, reporting after each consultation, reporting after each IGF event. These could include speaking points for observers from each sector, because I do support the point that while it might be easy for someone from the technical community to talk about the technical, someone from the private sector to talk about private sector interests, it's not always easy to communicate all of the other interests. And in order to weave them together into one unified message, I think, in fact, we have to tailor it to the audiences that we want to speak to so they understand what we're relating to. I can tell you that my personal observation, my first IGF meeting was at this time in Brazil, And it was very interesting for me to hear the different discussions, but to also really note that the discussions around private sector issues, particularly around brand protection, which is the issue of my association, was missing. And it's important that if there are contributions being made and we're not aware of it, that we communicate it with speaking points. I would also offer that whatever these speaking points look like, that we use the list of observers that are coming to the MAG to help generate that, to have an ongoing observer list, if not a MAG list. I know that there are different lists available now, but there might be an opportunity here for like a communications hub, a place where we can go to get very targeted communications information for our sectors and for the community at large. And I would definitely support that the MAG engage associations, particularly like associations like my own, that have their own internal communication structures that can help you start generating the grassroots input that you need. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. And maybe one quick comment, as I'm getting some sort of indication that this notion around the private sector somehow losing sort of significant interest is picking up some steam. I don't actually know that to be true. And I actually would suspect that there are probably more proposals that came in, but as a percentage, maybe there's a difference because they might have been overtaken by the enthusiasm of another stakeholder group, for instance. So I would just be careful about picking up on a statistics and looking at absolute numbers and percentages. We can certainly look at that later. It's something the Secretariat should do, because if we are losing support of any one of the significant stakeholder groups, we should certainly work to understand why and how we get that back up. So having said that, I will move to the next in the queue, which is Jimena Sierra. You have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Is listening? Okay. Thank you. Well, this is Jimena Sierra. I'm representing the technical community from the Federal Telecommunications Institute. And I just would like to share very quickly the useful output or ideas that I think that can engage the community after and in the retreat. So the first of this idea is to encourage the participation of the people with disabilities. And it's important to have the necessary infrastructure and facilities in the location, but also at the retreat, but also at the forum. Also, I would like to follow the idea of increase the participation of these new participants. And I think that this could be done to encourage training workshops for these new stakeholders so they can join in the discussions that will take place in the forum. And by the end of these ideas, I would like also to share that it is important that the results of the Internet Governance Forum have greater dissemination. And this will be by promoting the translation of the most relevant documents so the stakeholders can spread the IGF results within their respective organizations and countries. Thank you.
Thank you. Jivan, you have the floor.
Thank you. There's several things that I would like to talk about, but I will stick to one in the name of time. And that is how to think of, during this retreat, how to think of bringing stakeholders a bit closer together. Because I think that there is an unnecessary division between stakeholders that I would say is even solidifying. And that is unfortunate. So that would be that's the issue I want to talk about. But before that, I just want to echo something that, two things that were mentioned. One is the communicating results, and I'll just say that I think it's important. That needs to be focused on, certainly. And then what Mark and Nigel caught on, and that is the policy initiatives, the policy questions, and the IGF as the forum, perhaps to discuss these on a grand scale. Having said that, I think that I thought that actually that is what the IGF would have done from the beginning. And perhaps there was a feeling in the beginning that if the IGF went about that process, it could have taken over or stepped into the territory of existing bodies who have done their jobs well. So I think that now, after 10 years, we've seen that everybody's doing their job. The IGF is not about to do that. So it has a very specific role that it has proven for itself. And it is a good time, perhaps, to get into policy initiatives and to more substantial things. To get back to the stakeholder issue that I mentioned in the beginning, I think that there is an unfortunate inflation of divisions between the stakeholder groups, and some are better organized. And actually, the one group that keeps on being mentioned here that is somehow retreating, I would say, is quite strong in representing its interests, and that is a good thing, because the private sector is where things are happening, and it's a good thing if it's active and it's representing its interests. But other stakeholder groups have not been so effective in forwarding those interests. The good thing is if they can better understand what this is all about and say, okay, this is what we're thinking of doing. The bad thing is if new members come in and they see a division and are reminded by certain interests or groups or individuals who make a career out of making divisions. Now, those divisions are dangerous. And if that is, if that keeps on going, it could spill over into other policy areas. So the big games will be resolved in a different way. There's no need to bring them at the IGF and to the MOG. They will not influence, well, they will influence to some degree, but the IGF will not influence these big games. So it is bad if we keep on nurturing a feeling that there's some strong division between us. There isn't. Everybody who has intervened here and everybody who keeps on intervening in these meetings has very similar points of view, loves the internet, first of all, loves a free and open internet, first, you know, secondly. So it is, we should stop nurturing that there is strong divisions, and this retreat should certainly focus on how to bring the stakeholder groups together. Cheers.
Thank you, Jivan. Xiaodong, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to comment on the success of the IGF for the retreat. It's no doubt IGF is a success in the past 10 years on being a dialogue platform. But if IGF could be a success in the next 10 years, it's a common challenge for us. It might be better for retreat to consider and discuss. I think IGF is a forum with any meeting. We have thousands of participants in each meeting, but why not we try to highlight the most important governance issue in this year and try to outlook the future issues in next year? Maybe have some kind of editing team to make the material we discussed into an IGF annual report in a specific year. But how IGF success looks like, I think there's three points. The first, no past. The second, no future. The third, to build the collaboration. I think if people want to know what is the most important thing in the governance issue in this year, please come to IGF and see the forum report. If the people want to know what's the most important governance issue to pay attention next year, just come to IGF. But if people want to build the collaboration on internal governance and to find the way to solve the problem, please come to IGF to find your partners. I think if we could achieve this, I do believe IGF would be the most important and unique platform for people to attend and follow up. I think we should learn a lot from other successful forums. For example, the World Economic Forum. So, you know, in the World Economic Forum, it lists many key issues which need to be discussed and build agenda council, which is very helpful for the forum. And also the documents delivered by the forum is very useful. But I think in the past 10 years, we did a lot for IGF. But what's the achievement for the outcome? I mean, the outcome document is not very, formalized. I think it's, we have 200 or 300 proposals every year, but not very categorized a lot. We could find so many topics are discussed for many years and all are in the same track. But why not we build discussion group, speech on topics and ask members or some expert to chair the specific discussion group and to deliver the report in that topic. I think it's a form we can do. So I think it's just a comment. It's just a suggestion for retreat to discuss. Thank you.
No, thank you, Xiaodong. I'm going to read out the list of people in the queue and then close the queue. So it's closed now. More names keep popping up. I have Wanawit, then Suman, Segun, Chip Sharp, participant number 83, ICC Basis, Council of Europe, UNESCO, and Bianca Ho. And we'll close the queue after that so that we can move on to the next topic. I would ask, and an online participant, which we will definitely give support to, because if they're still hanging in there after all the difficulties of the day, they actually deserve certainly our attention and probably our applause. I would ask everybody to keep their interventions quite short, though, so we can ensure that there's adequate time for the remaining agenda items. Suman, you have the floor. Or, sorry, did Wanawit, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Wanawit Akubutra, MAC member, and currently the Vice Chair of the GACS in ICANN. I also would like to echo what Mark Carwell just mentioned, and I like to propose the models that I experienced in two aspects. One, Thailand just setting up the national multi-stakeholder committee chaired by the Prime Minister, which took us almost a year. And the lesson learned we have is also, I try to compare from the other floor I'm working in, UNECE. UNECE is coming out with the recommendations of National Trade Facilitation Board just recently, which reflect on the WTO. UNECE coming out with the recommendation that would lead to how every national organize themselves for the futures of the trading. And the major challenge we face when we setting up the committee is what is the functional that this national body should do. And without the recommendation, it will be different from one country to another. And I think the model that UNECE have been proposed, and currently WTO also put it in the trade facilitation agreements that normally they call Bali package, proved to be quite effective. Every country tried to setting up the National Trade Facilitation Board. The function is the same and the contact point is very clear. I think that internet, we have to think that it's everywhere, and seems to be half of the government is involved with internet. And that creates a problem in the government on how we organize ourselves, to whom should participate where, and then what is the public policy. And the international fora or trade negotiation, no matter TPP, RCEP, or whatever, is always related to internet. Maybe one of the biggest chapters is e-commerce, that there are a lot of things related to what be talking. And then I do believe that if the retreat was also touching based on how the government organized themselves locally to handling the internet in the harmonized way, I think that would be helping every country to really coming up with the right public policy. Thank you.
Thank you, Wanawit. Suman, you have the floor.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I just like to point out to one particular issue, that is the government engagement in the IGF process, especially in my region, South Asia. What I can see that the government doesn't have merely any participation in the IGF process, but they're suffering in many different issues like cybersecurity, like IPv6 preparation. They're trying to make the policy, but they're not taking the help of the IGF documents. We have IGF retreat, we'll have IGF retreat, we'll have IGF meeting in Mexico, and we'll prepare output documents. But somehow, those are not reaching to the right person of the government. I can see they're trying to handle this process, and in many cases, they're going in the wrong direction. So I just want to make a plea that we can make an arrangement so that this document reaches all the governments to the right people of the governments so that they can take help of those documents. Otherwise, some decision may really, in this present situation, when we can see a lot of terrorist activities, they're using internet for their communication, and sometimes we see the internet shut down in many different countries. So to avoid this, to take the best use of these documents to do the best thing, and we can see a better internet. So I don't know how, but whether we can take the help of UN or somehow, we need to reach these governments. Thank you.
Thank you, Suman. Now we have Segun. Segun, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Yeah, I've listened to various discussions and input, and I've listened on the need for us to have awareness and to strengthen the communication strategy of the IGF. But from what I've seen so far, from my own experience and from what we have heard from the community, I want to propose that there's a need to have a fundamental review of IGF as a non-binding engagement. What do I mean by that? You see, we've had series of occasions where the government side will be saying that, after all, IGF is a talk show. It has there is no binding outcome, effect, and all that. So they see IGF more as engagement of the civil society and probably business sector and all that. So I think there's a need for the retreat to look at the fundamental structure. The non-binding nature of the IGF has to be looked into. That is number one. That number two, I also would like to propose that if there's any way we can put in place assessment and evaluation of the IGF, it could be on a annual or biannual basis, so that the impact of the output of IGF can be measured. I don't know, but I believe that if we have that in place, then we will be able to compare where we are and where we are going. Then I would also would like to talk about the need to have a communication strategy that is more robust. I remember when we are discussing in our working group, we talk about the need to have an IGF resource center that has to be active and not just being robust. It should be a center for learning, you know, where the youth and the younger one can go in there and study issues or things that has to do with the IGF policy and all that. Then I would also like to talk about the need for us to improve the inclusion of the relevant technical community. Like, for example, I'm aware that IEEE, they have about 350,000 members. Then whenever we talk about IoT or smart initiatives and all that, these are the people that are essential to be part of that discussion. So in our own working group anyway, we are trying to find a way out to ensure that they are included in our outreaches and all that. So to go back to the first point that I made, the need to review the fundamental nature, the non-binding nature of the IGF, because not until when we do that, you will discover that the impression that the community have is that IGF is not really a binding engagement. Like, for example, they will give you the example of ITU, they will give you the example of ICANN. Even ICANN, you have the government actively participating in ICANN process, and they come back to the country and implement the outcome. But IGF, it's not so. So not until when we look at that fundamental nature of, I'm talking about the non-binding nature, how can we improve from that? Thank you.
Well, thank you, Segun. I mean, I think we all want to find a way to make the IGF as impactful as possible. And at the same time, just recall that the IGF actually operates under the Tunis agenda, which was reaffirmed in the WSIS plus 10. So there are some guidance there through those documents as well. Chip, you have the floor. As you've had the floor in this session already, could I ask you to keep your comments quite brief and the same for all the remaining to make their interventions. Chip, you have the floor.
Okay, sorry. I forgot to wait for my red light to come on. It's still not very clear to, you know, what is going to happen with the discussions that are going on at the retreat. So I'd just like to ask that in the discussions and in the whatever comes out of it, that there is some kind of information or guidance given as to what's going to happen with that information, who, you know, in terms of who's going to use it. I heard about the NIRs, but there's all kinds of other things in there. The other one, so that was one request. Second one is, you know, I think in terms of the input to the discussions at the retreat and talking about the outputs, we might be think about looking at improving the institutional memory and utilizing the outputs that we already have from previous IGFs in a more efficient manner and making them more available in a better way to people to use if needed. Before we start getting into discussions on recommendations and more negotiated agreements and outcomes, because before going down that path, there would need to be a extended discussion on working methods that we would have to have at some point. Thank you.
Thank you, Chip. Participant 83, introduce yourself to me.
Hi, Zahid Jamil from Pakistan Private Sector, member of ICC Basis. I'm one of the persons who are going to be at the retreat, and so I'm listening very carefully, and therefore this has been very helpful. And I agree with that it's helpful to have that transcript sent out to everybody. So thank you for that. I have a clarifying question because I just want to make sure that I'm clear on what, you know, our scope is. At the retreat. I've heard about the non-binding nature and the fundamental shift that needs to be considered at the retreat, and I think the Tunis agenda comment by the chair was helpful to try and say, well, there may be a certain picket fence around this. So my question is related to that. What is the scope of the retreat? Do we limit ourselves to the five questions, or given some of the things that were raised right now in the comments we've heard, do we go beyond those five questions to even discuss things such as matters that have already been settled at the CSTD or elsewhere and put to rest, or can we reopen and revisit? If we can, I just like to know. As an example, we hear the word output, which has always meant for the last 10 years the chairman's report and summary of the IGF versus an outcome, which might be a negotiated outcome. And if we are open to discussing that, I'd just like to know whether that's something, because I didn't read that from the five questions, but it'll be good to know what our scope is for the retreat. Thank you.
We'll go through the rest of the questions, and then Wyman has a couple of summing up remarks at the end. ICC Basis, you have the floor. Hi, Carolyn. It's ICC, yes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Carolyn Nguyen from Microsoft, and we are a member of ICC Basis. I wanted to address a couple of comments that's come up this afternoon. So firstly, with respect to the division, I'd like to remind all of us of how strongly the multi-stakeholder collaborated and worked together to ensure a positive WSIS plus 10 review and outcome. And it would be great if that sense of community and collaboration continue as we discuss the next 10 year of the IGF. With respect to the earlier question about, you know, what would be success for the IGF, I think that the WSIS plus 10 outcome document laid that out pretty clearly. And so there are some very measurable goals in there in terms of what needs to be done. I think the other part is that the document highlighted the socioeconomic importance of the development of the information society, and furthermore, the alignment of the technological development with the SDGs. And those economic factors are something that we should really keep in mind as we think about the impact, Madam Chair, to your word, going forward. And in that light, one of the things that we'd like to bring up as part of the private sector is how to be inclusive of SMEs. There are challenges in terms of bringing in participation of SMEs, in particular from developing countries around the world, And they are the key to sustainable national economic development going forward. They are creating the economic opportunities to attain some and realize the SDGs as we talk about. And so to the earlier conversation with respect to, I believe, the representative from the UK in terms of improving remote participation, we see that as a critical sort of discussion to increase the impact of the IGF going forward. The IGF has always been a recognized forum for relevant, timely discussions among stakeholders, and I think that's what it really needs to be, going back to the first principles, Madam Chair, as you mentioned, from the Tunis agenda. I would hope that this would be a major objective that we can take on at the IGF retreat. I believe that the success for the retreat would be open collaborative discussion, as has been put forward in terms of under Chatham House rule, that we can really do come back together under the same collaborative spirit that we had in December to work together to strengthen the IGF going forward. Again, back to those first principles from the Tunis agenda. With respect to the conversations around outcome, I believe that there are two things that are being conflated. One is a report of the discussion that's happened at the IGF, and secondly, the communication and archiving of those discussions going forward. It's more than a communication strategy. It is also a mapping that's required to make the discussion and the information much easier to find going forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Carolyn. Next, it's Council of Europe. Lee, you had an intervention already on this, so if I could ask you to keep it very short. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Very shortly. My point is about roles and responsibilities. I mean, we're all here because we have different roles and responsibilities. I come here on behalf of the Council of Europe to find out more about the human rights aspects of internet governance and to take it back to Strasbourg, which then influences policy perhaps in there. So I was prompted to intervene because when I looked at the main session proposals, for example, internet governance and trade, and the reference to the WTO, then surely the part of the role of roles and responsibilities coming together here is to collaborate and to try to work out or to try to invite those with the responsibilities to take that back to where they're from and to deliberate and discuss on perhaps policy in their field. So is it the role of WTO to come here and talk about trade and internet governance and then to take it back at the invitation of the IGF? So my point is, if we're going to talk about an open, safe, secure, inclusive internet within our respective roles and responsibilities, and if we get our, if we have clarity on what priorities we're looking at and what communication plans and success therefore, then we can have clearer roles and responsibilities in coming and going back. Can we use the IGF to go and come back and to clarify those roles and responsibilities? Can we use the IGF to task or to invite those to act upon on discussion here and then also to report back to show progress? Thank you.
Thank you, Lee. UNESCO, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynn, and thank you for giving me the floor. I also like to thank you for accepting UNESCO to the retreat. As you know that we have been supporting IGF since 10 years ago. I'm so happy to be here meeting so many friends, and many of you were there for 10 years and like me. So we really have a lot to say, but I know we'll discuss more at the retreat. And now I'd like to share the experience from UNESCO, since we have been discussing why IGF, what is good about it. And if you look back to the past 10 years, UNESCO has been benefiting from IGF so much, at least in the three areas. First, on the policy area. I mean, IGF is a forum. It's not a policymaker, but UNESCO is a policy. Well, we are working with a policymaker. We have been sensitized by IGF on so many emerging issues. For example, privacy. For example, intermediaries are liability issues, how they are impacting free expression, human rights, access, and human and education, etc. This impact is so profound that we conduct research, policy recommendation, and even until last year,
in December 2015, our general conference has adopted a resolution by all the member states that we endorsed a new framework on internet universality principles as the organization's guiding principles for internet-related policymaking. And this contains that we endorse the multi-stakeholder approach, and we take in the new issues like privacy into a new work in the post-2015 strategy. So you see that as an intergovernmental organization, we are working with policymakers. We are able to channel the new knowledge to our daily work to help governments to make sure in their policy making process to be more inclusive, to take in the new issues, and to make sure that all the policy regarding to internet will be compliant with international standards and considering the international discussions. And second area I want to mention is a partnership. Yes, there are divisions, but I see more coalitions. In past 10 years, without IGF building up partnership, I wouldn't invest in how UNESCO can work so extensively now with not only other IGOs within UN agencies and also beyond regional and national. And also we work with so much with the private sector. We work together with Google, with many internet companies, also including those in the developing country. We get them on board to discuss, and we conduct a joint initiative. And also we work with the technical community. We work closely with ISOC, with many other technical organizations, which we won't have worked without this platform. We realize that, okay, we are really working on the same issues. And of course, NGO and the civil society, we have been working so much with them. We invite them to UNESCO conference in addition to the IGF, so and at all levels. And the third area I want to mention is that if even on the implementation level, now we have seen that the IGF is creating the best practice platform, and also the NRIs I'm learning today. I mean, the national and the regional IGFs are prospering everywhere. We have been advising our regional and national offices of UNESCO to actively participate in this NRIs. And nowadays, internet becomes such a central issue, even at developing countries. That's why our field office found it very, very, very useful. They actively use our framework to propose the activities with the local stakeholders through the NRIs. So you see that the global idea strategy will get penetrating to the local level through IGF and also through partnerships through our own constituencies in a different way. So it's a complicated, it's a complex procedure and perspective you need to assess the impact of IGF. Not that straightforward, but it takes time. It takes different interactions to get there. So I'm looking forward to further discussion with all stakeholders. And I think it's already a good starting, and it's well done in past 10 years. And for the future, of course, we need more discussion about the even technical level, like communication strategy of IGF to deliver the impact more and better, and also other to be more inclusive how to get it. So, all in all, I'm so satisfied with the past 10 years. I believe we will do even better in the future 10 years, particularly in light of the achieving the SDGs in 15 years.
Thank you. Thank you. Some very, very good comments. I'm going to go to an online participant, and then we have Bianca and Wai Min for some closing comments.
I'm going to read a comment from Deirdre Williams. David Souter made an excellent point in his retreat submission. Many people have fears about the internet, but they are not represented in our discussions on its governance. It is important that people who hold different views from those which are prevalent in the IGF today are fully included in its work as it goes forward. For the IGF to attract attention, be newsworthy, we need to include these people whose perspective is different and who may inform things for the current insiders. The IGF community must be inclusive. As we include these next billions, they must also be persuaded that they have a right to a voice in how the policy is created and an obligation to use that voice. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you to all the online participants for hanging in there. I know it's been a challenging day technology-wise. Bianca, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm Bianca Ho, MAG member. So I wanted to echo on Mark and Jivan's points, the importance of continuing to make it an open and inclusive space to speak up, particularly using retreat as a place to discuss the mechanisms to ensure that, of which I think promoting participation is not only between different stakeholder groups, you know, like government, private sector, civil society, but also within, right? So developing and developed world, gender, youth. So I think that's important to keep in mind. And also, you know, considering marginal groups, you know, including, you know, youth members particularly, I do agree that remote participation has to be taken so seriously that it, even though they don't have the funds or resources to travel to the IGF, they would still get the same experience per se for anyone who's physically there. And the other point I wanted to make is it's important to, I think it was mentioned earlier that to keep in mind how to make it relevant for different stakeholder groups and, you know, translating the value of IGF. So I think that's also another topic that could be discussed during the retreat. Thank you.
Thank you, Bianca. I want to thank everybody for participating in this discussion. It obviously doesn't end here. If you have other thoughts, you should feel free to share them. There are many vehicles for doing that. I want to give the last few words to Wai Min, and then we'll move to the next agenda item. Wai Min, you have the floor.
Yeah, thank you, Lynn. So thank you for all your very useful comments and very wise advice indeed. Lee started off with the question about what is the success of the IGF. I think there were several follow-up to that and some giving very, very thoughtful comments, some questions, and all this, I think, will be very constructive to inform the retreat itself. Speaking of which, there's actually a list of all these background documents online, which is also not just for the retreat participants, but for everyone to know, including the CSTD Working Group Improvement to IGF, the ongoing work of the MAG, of the Secretariat, and all other relevant documents. There's also one specific document. If you look at the in the website, under background documents, for the retreat, the first document is actually a document put up by the IGF Secretariat, and that includes some guiding questions for the retreat itself. But this is not a final document. So the retreat discussion, I think there were some questions posed whether it will be restricted to the five areas. I think it's quite fluid, but we are also mindful that it's just a two-day retreat, and given this constraint, it's not. I think we're not an ambitious not to say that the retreat itself is a panacea. It's definitely not an end in itself. It's as what we first started. It's the ongoing process. It will go back again to the community for consultations. How it is being done, Lynn has suggested some way following the past efforts, and I think that is one way to consider, and how they will be again to be further consulted, including at the IGF in Guadalajara itself. My final input is to say that it is very much a learning process for all of us. It's a learning process for DESA, and I think, including myself, of course, and we very much count on your continued advice and support to see how, not just for retreat, but the ongoing, how we can together as a group to further the mandate of IGF. Thanks.
Thank you, Wai Min. I appreciate your comments and certainly appreciate all the effort you're putting into this and staying with us as well. With that, we move to the next agenda item, which is briefings from other related or relevant initiatives and organizations. There have been a number of presentations posted online as a part of this agenda. We might as well just work right through them, although I must admit I'm not quite sure how the Stanford University deliberative poll is going to be presented. Is there somebody here in the... Okay. So let's start with that one. We'd asked everybody to keep their presentations quite short. If the MAG needs more time for discussion going forward, we can look to schedule that in the next couple of days, but I want to make sure we can get through what is now, I think, seven initiatives with Friends of the IGF being added as well. So, and could you please introduce yourself as well? Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, MAG, and everyone here today. We're very excited to have this opportunity to present our ideas and our plans for what we'd like to do at the upcoming IGF. My name is Alice Hsu. I'm here on behalf of Stanford with two research centers, Center for Deliberative Democracy and Center for Democracy Development and Rule of Law. And in particular, some of our team members who some of you know couldn't be here, Eileen Donahoe, Max Angus, Larry Diamond, and James Fishkin, and they send their regards. So last year we had our first pilot event at the IGF, and it was a combination of online and face-to-face. Some of you here may have been participants or witnessed the event. It was on the topic of increasing access to the internet, and it was extremely successful. The final report and all the results have been posted and been circulated, and you're all welcome to review the report. Some of the findings, the most interesting, actually, what we found was opinion change was actually possible among an expert community like yourselves. One of the concerns prior to the event was whether deliberation among experts would have any effect, because you all talk about this all the time and you're experts in it. But we found in our results was that experts are actually able to have some opinion change and significant opinion change when actually gathered into a room deliberating with people that they don't know very well. You're happy to, you're welcome to read the extensive report online. In this coming year, we'd like to do something similar. We'd like to have an event on day zero where we can gather participants that are already coming to IGF to discuss on an issue of current kind of hot topic is governing digital encryption. We're switching the topic because the team felt that it would be interesting to bring this topic to the IGF this year. And like last year, we have an extensive advisory committee producing balanced briefing materials. We'll have pre and post surveys, and we hope to do the event online prior to the IGF to engage remote participants that aren't able to come, and also to have the event face-to-face as well. And this year, echoing some of the sentiment that I've heard today, we're looking to actively bring members from the Global South and folks that may probably or may not have been able to go otherwise, and we're trying to do our best to recruit in that way. We're really hoping that the results from this coming event and the results from the prior event last year will be able to serve as insights to everyone here, to the IGF community, and to be able to share our experiences with everyone as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to just take one quick moment and ask Chengatai to make a logistics announcement in case there are people in and out with respect to the passes. I just want to make sure we don't lose anybody at the end of the day, because your passes are just for today.
Okay. People with passes, the stickers, you need new passes for tomorrow since we're meeting in a different room. You can fetch them today. You just see Eleonora or Adriana at the corner there, and they'll give you the new passes. For those new who are coming tomorrow, there will be a chance to get them the same time and place for today. Or those people who have left today as well can come tomorrow morning and get them like we did today.
Just an additional announcement to that is that please pick up the passes only for yourself, and you are for sure they'll be coming for the next 2 days, because we do have a limited number of passes, so we would not want to go without a pass for someone who is really coming tomorrow. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry for introducing that, but I really didn't want people to leave and not be aware and try to scramble tomorrow morning to find the appropriate pass. So with that, the next speaker is from the World Economic Forum Internet for All Initiative. I think that's Eric. You have the floor. Could you light the WEF mic, please? World Economic Forum, WEF.
WEF. Oh, do I have to push a button? Ah.
I think it was operator error. Okay, thank you very much, Madam Chair, for the introduction and the opportunity to address the group today. My name is Eric White. I am the project lead at the World Economic Forum for the Internet for All initiative. Internet for All is one initiative under the forum's Future of Digital Economy and Society system, on which the MAG chair is a steward, I'm happy to say. It uses the Forum's platform for multi-stakeholder collaboration to expand internet inclusion globally. Earlier this year, the initiative launched a guiding framework that lays out how we view the issue. It essentially says that in order to achieve internet for all, multi-stakeholder collaboration is required both within and across four barriers: infrastructure, affordability, digital skills and awareness, and local content. And I should add that we worked with the IGF Secretariat as we developed this paper, and we drew from the Connecting the Next Billion work. We're very grateful for that support. So we see IGF as a key partner in this work and a group with which we look forward to continuing to work very closely. More about the project. Internet for All has as its principal goal to facilitate the development and acceleration of new scalable and replicable business models of public-private collaboration on internet inclusion. As a secondary goal, we're enabling a physical and a digital platform to ease this collaboration. Globally, we're guided by a steering committee of 30 organizations. This includes the IGF Secretariat, the ITU, ICANN, mobile operators such as Telefonica and Vimpelcom, equipment manufacturers such as Cisco, Huawei, Ericsson. Should nod to my colleague at Microsoft sitting to my left, also on our steering committee. It includes development banks, governments, civil society organizations such as the World Wide Web Foundation, and many others. To launch the global platform, we're having a high-level roundtable on Internet for All in Geneva at the World Economic Forum headquarters in August. The idea is that this group that we convene will continue to meet and continue their coordination at various events throughout the year to come. This is part of the reason that we've submitted a panel proposal for the IGF in Guadalajara, as we see the IGF as a venue where this type of collaboration among the same partners can continue. Additionally to the global platform, we're establishing three country or regional level platforms, one in East Africa and what we call the Northern Corridor, so that's Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, and South Sudan, one in Latin America, and one in South Asia. These platforms will have local steering committees that include ministers, private sector, civil society, intergovernmental organizations, and academics, among others. They will work through working groups constituted by stakeholders and coordinated by a permanent secretariat. And these working groups will set goals and develop activities for implementation. In East Africa, the four governments have committed to using this platform to create 25 million additional internet users in the region by 2019. Finally, just a quick comment to highlight what I see as the synergies between the Forum's Internet for All project and the IGF. So as I mentioned, we've submitted a panel request, and we look forward to hopefully participating in December in Guadalajara. We welcome the participation of Chengatai on our Internet for All Steering Committee and by the MAG Chair on our overall system stewardship group. We see room for participants by these groups in our meetings. We will... And we actually, something I wanted to mention that I just learned about today is that I see room for participation of NRIs, and so this is a term new to me because I'm new to the IGF, in our local platforms that we're developing around the world in those regions. So I want to close by stressing that I'm here because we're interested in collaboration. We see IGF as a key partner, and we look forward to continuing to do that. That's it.
Thank you, Alex. I see a request from 199, participant member 199. We'll take a comment. Has anybody asked for the floor? Have you asked, would you like to speak? I can't tell because the mic keeps going red, green. I'm assuming not then. With all of these initiatives, as Alex said, there's been a pretty close collaboration between the Connecting the Next Billion effort and their Internet for All initiative that has primarily been led through the Secretariat and Constance, I think. And I think one of the things that we need to address going forward is how we can appropriately support appropriate activities with other organizations and where some of the leadership for those interfaces should come from. I think that's a bigger discussion that we have time for now, but perhaps we can put that on some future calls or even at the third MAG meeting later in the year. In the meantime, the efforts to understand where there are some collaboration opportunities continues. The next item we have is the Global Internet Policy Observatory. Christina, is European Commission's mic, please.
Raise your hand.
Yes. There. Thank you very much, and thank you, Chair, for the opportunity to briefly report on progress on the Global Internet Policy Observatory, or GIPO. GIPO is an automated tool to collect, process, and analyze information related to internet governance and policy. It is an initiative that was kick-started by the European Commission to help stakeholders, in particular those with limited resources, to have better access to the many issues and documents related to internet governance and policy. The beta version of the tool is available online since February, and in June, a new upgraded and improved version was presented during the European Dialogue on Internet Governance. The GIPO tool is what we could call the engine. It automatically scans relevant information from quality sources, and it automatically processes and analyzes the information, basically by categorizing items in 7 different baskets, which are infrastructure, economic, security, legal, development, socio-cultural, and human rights issues. And for this, it uses the same taxonomy that was developed by Diplo Foundation, who has extensively worked on these issues, and it also used by the Geneva Internet Watch. And the tool also assigns automatically tags and metadata to each item. All this work done by the engine, by the GIPO tool, facilitates the search and retrieve of information by users who have different options to navigate through the information and refine their searches, also according to specific geographical areas or periods of time. In particular, the dashboard graphically displays the information to further help the user. This dashboard allows for a histogram panel that shows results of a search item over time, as well as geographical coverage of the topic by showing a map. To do this, GIPO relies on a mix of open source tools, and it is being gradually developed in an open way by asking feedback and input from interested parties, by connecting to experts in different fields, and by looking to address the needs expressed by potential users. GIPO is not replacing or duplicating other tools, but rather it is thought to be complementary to them. And indeed, while developing GIPO, the cooperation with other initiatives in this field has been paramount in making sure GIPO serves others' organization needs. For instance, JIPO now provides an open API, an application programming interface, that allows programmers to make apps, websites, and widgets that interact with JIPO's content. Other initiatives can use JIPO to customize and integrate the dashboard in their websites, thereby enriching it with additional features. We have already successfully tested the customization and integration of the dashboard with AXIS, which is the largest African civil society organization active in ICT for development. AXIS used the JIPO dashboard and customized it on their website to monitor internet governance and policy in Africa. This cooperation is very positive and can easily be replicated with other organizations. In this way, the many initiatives active in internet governance can focus on what they do best, and in particular, they can support their specific constituencies and target groups, and they don't need to worry too much and invest resources in the technology, which is already available and provided by JIPO. The positive cooperation with other players also spans to other types of activities, like, for instance, the exchange of information on how to address common challenges, like multilingualism, data visualization, different legal issues, and even how to understand users' needs, and in general, what are the factors to be considered when developing this kind of tools and platforms. In this context, the JIPO Advisory Group has been of key importance. The group brings together 12 experts in different areas and is providing guidance throughout the development of JIPO. They met recently on the margins of Eurodig for a special workshop on the contribution of JIPO to multi-stakeholderism. The discussion was very interesting and stimulating, and the outcomes are currently being summarized in a paper. And the intention is to present this in more detail during the open forum in Mexico. Finally, a word on the potential use of JIPO by the IGF. While the Commission is financing the development of the tool, it never intended to be the final owner once it becomes fully operational. As a global tool for the multi-stakeholder community, JIPO will need an appropriate home from which it can be managed in and for the global public interest. The IGF could potentially be that home. Some initial contacts have been made to this purpose, including at technical level, to better understand how JIPO could support IGF in fulfilling its mandate, in particular in the areas of capacity building, in ensuring more informed discussions, and in creating opportunities for cooperation. Thank you.
Thank you, Christina. The next item up is the Net Mundial Initiative, and Marilia, are you going to speak to that? You have the floor. Marilia, please.
Thank you, Lynn. This is Marilia Maciel speaking. I actually wanted to make a comment on the previous agenda item, and then I will switch to the Net Mundial Initiative, if that is possible. So my comment is actually on behalf of DIPLO Foundation. We are very happy to recognize the evolution of the different observatories and platforms and initiatives to map different areas of internet governance. We believe that this is extremely valuable for many stakeholders, newcomers, to come and try to navigate this very complex and multidisciplinary environment of internet governance. A wide range of tools are available to all out there. We just heard about the algorithm run automated feeds coming from JIPO. There is also human-curated resources and analysis that are being produced by the Geneva Internet Platform Digital Watch. But moving forward, we would like to make a suggestion, which is that maybe a more ambitious and fructuous approach in the future would be the adoption of a common IG taxonomy that could be used by the different tools and platforms available out there. This could ensure a certain level of consistency between the different approaches and platforms, and foster more clarity when we try to analyze internet governance issues. So we would like to suggest that the IGF creates a working group that would gather the institutions, the individuals that are working with observatories and mapping initiatives, and the role of this working group would be and to present and to try to explore the idea presented before about a common taxonomy. This group should work in close collaboration with the IGF, and maybe in the future the IGF website could serve as a one-stop shop for gathering information coming from all these mapping exercises. So I just would like to highlight that Diplo Foundation and the Geneva Internet Platform would like to assist to implement this idea of creating a working group if this idea moves forward. So this is my comment on behalf of Diplo Foundation and the previous point. And now moving on to the Net Mundial initiative, if there are no further comments about the previous point. I just would like to provide you a quick update on the Net Mundial initiative as the former Net Mundial initiative co-chair. As you know, the Net Mundial initiative was created to provide a platform to catalyze efforts to implement and advance the principles that were collaboratively drafted during the Net Mundial meeting in Brazil. The coordinating council has worked together for 18 months, and the mandate has expired now in June. Members of the Coordinating Council have met together in ICANN 56 in Helsinki, and they have provided a final statement making an assessment about the work that has been developed in these 18 months and looking for the future. So one of the things that we have recognized with great happiness is that in this past 2 years, Net Mundial principles have been adopted by a broad range of organizations, such as the BRICS. Declaration makes mention to Net Mundial principles, the WISIS Plus 10, the G7 Declaration, the OECD Ministerial Declaration, Council of Europe, the European Commission, and so on. So we are happy to see that, and individually and working together as a coordinating council, we try to be champions of these principles, and we know that many of you that helped to draft them have been champions of these principles as well, and this was a good step moving forward. The Net Mundial initiative in these months have developed two platforms that we believe are a legacy to the community. One of them is the Net Mundial collaboration platform. It's a collaborative space aiming to help to catalyze practical cooperation between stakeholders around internet governance projects and ideas. The second one is the Net Mundial solutions map that we believe is one of the first crowdsourced internet governance mapping efforts where anyone can share and access information about internet governance, connecting issues, actors, responses, resources that are available out there. So moving forward, from now on, we have this products. What we discussed during our meeting in Helsinki is that until December this year, ICANN will be hosting and taking care of the continuation of the Net Mundial Solutions map with the aim of strengthening and enhancing it, making it more known and available and operational. But with time, we believe that other organizations in the community should share the responsibility to update this map. After all, this is a collaborative effort. I will pass the microphone to my colleague Flavio Wagner in a moment so he can give updates about what CGI will work on in the future. But we also discussed that we cannot stop here in terms of assessing the Net Mundial principles. It's very important that we develop a Net Mundial follow-up track, and this is something that we would like to present to you, especially the members of the MAG. We believe that this follow-up track of Net Mundial should be something carried out in collaboration, in close collaboration with the IGF. The IGF could be a moment, an opportunity to periodically assess the progress of the implementation of Net Mundial outcome document in view of maybe, if we assess that it would be a useful thing to do, calling up the organization of a Net Mundial plus 5 or plus 10 in the future, so we could together assess the progress that we have achieved from that moment on. So moving forward, I think that this would be the main tracks in our agenda. And besides what Flavio will comment in a few moments, we just would like to thank all of you who have participated in the open consultations for discussing the documents that we have put on the website, that have shared your suggestions, and principally to the ones that have helped to move forward with the principles of Net Mundial that we believe are principles that we all share and we should strive to see more and more implemented in the future. Flavio, please.
Could you please give the floor to Flavio Wagner, please?
Yeah. Thank you, Madam Chair. So thank you, Marilia, for the report on the decisions taken in Helsinki by the Net Mundial Coordination Council. As Marilia said, one of the products of the initiative was the Net Mundial Collaboration Platform. And this shall continue, this effort. And beginning July 2016, so now, CGI.br, so the Brazilian Internet Steering Committee, will coordinate efforts around the Net Mundial Collaboration Platform, which is, as Marilia said, a space for showcasing projects that are relevant for the effective deployment of the governance principles established in the Net Mundial Statement and also for the advancement of its roadmap. So CGI.br is committed to provide all the administrative and operational structures that are needed for the platform to achieve the goals envisioned by the Coordination Council of the Net Mundial Initiative. CGI.br will not be involved in funding the projects that are showcased through the Net Mundial platform, but in really taking care of the platform itself. So CGI.br will very soon provide further details on the proposal of a very lightweight multi-stakeholder coordination structure for guiding the development and operation of the platform. And for this, as it has always done, it will work in close partnership with stakeholders from across the world, following the collaborative model that guided the Net Mundial meeting itself in 2014.
Thank you, Flavio. I think there's a request from ICANN, Nigel, for the floor on this same subject. You have the floor, ICANN.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Good afternoon. Just to follow up on that very useful comments about the Net Mundial Initiative, ICANN, as one of the partners, would certainly like to endorse what Marilia said about the interface with the IGF and the great synergy that was that took place in the last couple of ICANN in the last couple of IGF meetings. I think it's worth saying that although the Net Mundial Initiative itself might have ended with the council meeting in Helsinki, the principles live on and the spirit of cooperation and multi-stakeholder participation lives on at the OECD Ministerial on the Digital Economy in Cancun a couple of weeks ago. In the ministerial declaration, the value of the principles was highlighted, and I think the suggestions and ideas just put forward by both Marilia and Flavia are very valuable indeed. ICANN has indeed taken on a commitment to discuss with partners, colleagues, etc., in terms of finding a way that the solutions map can be used, because it certainly has a degree of utility, along with the other initiatives that Marilia spoke about and the European Commission spoke about. And so hopefully the idea of having some sort of working group or something of the MAG on this issue might be very useful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I mean, I'd like to just make a comment from the last three or four speakers who have actually, made some very interesting and I think some very full offers. I think it's something the MAG needs to go away and consider how best to address that. That clearly needs to be done with DESA, as there are obviously implications within the UN system. And then, of course, there's the management issue and ongoing support as well. So I don't want anybody to think that we're just running from one to another. We'll need to find a proper way to actually engage more fully in those discussions. The next on the list is the ITU. Update, and I think Pritam is joining us remotely or as an online participant. So, Pritam, you have the floor.
Yes, Pritam will speak remotely. Breton, please, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. This is Preetam Malur from the ITU. Thank you, Madam Chair, for the opportunity to update the group on ITU's recent work. And let me also thank you. Just update from our side. The ITU Council in June 2016 highlighted and reiterated ITU's commitment to the implementation of the SDGs, particularly in terms of increasing access to ICTs worldwide. David Navarro, the special advisor to the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development, addressed the delegates at our governing body meeting. So ITU is currently developing a mapping tool intended to essentially serve as a one-stop shop for information on what ITU is doing, not only in the work, which is the foundation for ITU's work on the SDGs. And of course, ITU will stakeholders. In terms of updates on this, the Business Forum 2017 is scheduled to take place from 12 to 16 June 2017 at the ITU HQ. The core ITU, UNESCO, UNCTAD, UNDP, we've launched the open consultation process on the thematic aspects on the innovations for the format of the Business Forum 2017. The first physical meeting of the 7th of October here in Geneva. And for the information on the next page is online. Interesting open consultation process that's going on is the one conducted by the ITU Council working group on Paul. You may know that's at a plenipotentiary. Held consultations with all stakeholders in Geneva. And we've held consultations on a diverse group of topics, IXPs, accessibilities, various topics. And the current round of consultations, it's on building an enabling environment for access to the internet. With questions related to internet connectivity, affordability, quality of access, security, and the role of governments in building these enabling environments. So the online component is open till 11th September. It's followed by a physical consultation meeting on 11th October. And we really look forward to the participation of all of you in consultation, especially given the focus of the IGF on policy options for connecting and enabling the next billion segment, you know. Links to these consultations are all available online on the ITU website. We can easily provide the links to be put on the IGF website also if you choose to do so. And in closing, I'd like to confirm ITU's active participation in this year, IGF in Guadalajara. We've already submitted our session proposals, which are co-opted by the UN agencies, and we really look forward to the outcome of this meeting. And I look forward to meeting many of you in the retreat in person. I apologize for not being there for the MAG meeting, but I'll see you in a couple of days. Thank you.
Preetam, thank you. And thank you, because I know it's very late in Geneva as well. The transmission wasn't all that clear. If by any chance you have your comments written down, if you could actually send them to the secretary, we'll make sure that the transcript reflects them properly. Maybe the transcript even caught them quite well. I can't see it, but it was a little difficult at times here in the room. But thank you again very much. I appreciate your sticking with all the online difficulties, and again, given the lateness of the hour in Geneva. The next request was for Friends of the IGF, and I think that's Flavio Wagner who's going to speak to that as well. If you could turn Flavio's mic on.
Thank you, Lynn. So it's me again. Now talking about the Friends of the IGF. So the project Friends of
of the IGF is a community-built archive of IGF discussions dating back to the inaugural IGF event in Athens, Greece, in 2006. So the mission of the project is to preserve the record of the IGF by compiling and organizing the various transcripts, videos, agendas, and reports from all IGF sessions into a browsable, searchable website database. Following the IGF 2015 in João Pessoa in Brazil, CGI.br, the Brazilian Internet Steering Committee, stepped forward to become the new steward of the project and seeks the support of the IGF community in further developing and sustaining the archive website. So CGI.br already hosts the project website, which I strongly invite you to visit at friendsoftheigf.org, and will give all necessary technical and administrative support to further development of the project. So the project was developed through a bottom-up, open and inclusive community process. Many individuals and organizations led by Susan Chalmers, which is behind me here, member of the MAG until last year, contributed both financially and in kind to the effort. It will be very important to maintain this practice, to maintain existing relationships and to establish new ones with key stakeholders. A multi-stakeholder steering committee composed of members of the IGF community will work to guide the development of the Friends of the IGF project and website. Among other tasks, this committee will be responsible for planning and fundraising for the redevelopment of the website for the IGF 2017. We should include enhanced search capabilities, a plan for tagging of content, a plan for interoperation with other relevant online projects, for example, JIPO, the Global Internet Policy Observatory, text and data mining capabilities, options for translation, and reaching out to national and regional initiatives to invite the uploading of content to the database. It is very important to highlight that the Friends of the IGF website complements the official IGF website by providing easy access to IGF transcripts and videos. Interoperability between both websites will be sought through cooperation with the IGF Secretariat as well with MAG members. By its very nature, the Friends of the IGF website supports the recommendations of the CSTD Working Group on IGF Improvements, and we hope that as the IGF community advances in its strategic discussion for the next 10 years, that Friends of the IGF will be considered as part of that discussion. And I would like to give the word to Susan, please.
Okay, Susan.
Thank you, Chair. thank you, Flavio. My name is Susan Chalmers, and speaking in my personal capacity, I would like to express appreciation and support for CGI.br assuming leadership of the Friends of the IGF project. As the previous lead of the project, I could say that over the past 3 years, it has really been developed in an open and multi-stakeholder way. And it was beautiful to see different members of the IGF community come together and support building this archive. I have every confidence that the capable team at CGI will do a great job. And collaboration is key. So I think that is important that we work together with important initiatives, other initiatives such as JIPO. Together we can all work to preserve our shared history of soon to be 11 years of invaluable discussions on internet governance and policy issues at the IGF. And the working group proposed by Marilia might be a good way to move forward and step with the balance of the community. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Susan. Peter Dengate-Thrush asks for the floor as well. Peter.
Thank you, Chair. Peter Dengate-Thrush. First of all, just congratulations to .br for picking up this project. Thank you very much. And a question, you've asked for a support. What form would you like that support to take? What is it that we can do as a MAG or as a community to help you with this project?
If there's a brief response, we'll have it. Otherwise, I think when we look at the JIPO and the DiploWatch and all of these projects, I think they're all very, very intertwined, not the least of which is what makes most sense for the IGF and the MAG. So I think it really is a very, very big topic, and we should determine how we come forward with that within the MAG. If there's a quick response, then you should certainly do that, but... do you light Flavio's mic, please?
So, Peter, with regard to the Friends of the IGF project in particular, the idea is that we build a very lightweight structure with representatives from different stakeholder communities to guide the project in the future. But of course, we would like very much to have liaisons to all the community, to all entities that are willing to support the project, both with ideas, making easier to retrieve contents that are valuable for the website, but also helping with funding, or at least finding the right funding for extending the resources and the contents in the website.
Thank you, Flavio. Council of Europe has asked for the floor, and with that last intervention, we'll close out this agenda item and then move on to the final one. So, Lee, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Now, in terms of substance, the Council of Europe does a lot of substantive work in the field of public policy making on internet and internet-related issues, and it formalized that support for the IGF last year in a declaration which the 47 member states adopted. So we have a formal, you know, very strong support for IGF going into 2016 and beyond, of course, and also because that declaration supported IGF for the next 10 years. My job is to see how IGF wants the Council of Europe to support its work intersessionally and also on site in Guadalajara. So I really am here also to listen to you where you see which expertise you need, you know, which types of support, which types of capacity building, etc. When I looked through the workshop proposals, I counted approximately 80 workshop proposals out of 260, which relate directly to the work that we do in Strasbourg. Work which involves human rights, which involves rule of law and democracy issues, and that's all wrapped up in an internet governance strategy for 2016 to 2019, which I would ask you, invite you to look at. There's plenty of work there. I would just like to say that there's a lot of legally binding treaties adopted and developed in Strasbourg. Treaties, you know some of them. The Budapest Convention on Cybercrime has a global vocation. The Convention 108 on Data Protection. There are treaties, legally binding standards on medicrime, on trafficking in human beings, on violence against women and domestic violence, bioethics, the protection of children, their sexual exploitation and abuse, and also on terrorism. And many of those legal treaties now are looking at the internet in their day-to-day work. There are reports out there that there are, you know, that the member states and other observers are deliberating on how these treaties interact with the internet. So I really would like to mention that there are mechanisms, legal mechanisms with monitoring attached to them, which looks at the ways to make sure that, you know, issues regarding crime online can be addressed, both between governments but also with other actors too. My point is, how do we input that this year and beyond? There are a number of other other types of expertise that we can bring. We have movements or campaigns on no hate speech online. We have a web platform which allows for alerts regarding the safety of journalists and the protection of journalism. We have indicators on internet freedom, which can help to measure how much freedom you have in a country. There's also descriptors for questions of citizenship and digital citizenship. And, of course, we have the case law of the European Court of Human Rights, which carries on in different fields regarding things such as intermediary liability. We have work on algorithms, on cloud evidence, and questions of law enforcement across borders, etc. Two areas of work I want to mention in particular this year. One, which is that we have a comparative study of the laws and practices in the 47 countries on illegal content filtering and blocking and takedown of content, an 800-page document, which can be summarized, which can be conveyed to the IGF, for example. And we also have a new, let's say, forum or platform on human rights and the role of business in respecting and protecting human rights, which is being developed. So There's far too much work there to try to summarize cleanly and easily to digest. I will send something to the list, but I would really appreciate your support in going forward. Which expertise, which areas of priority do you wish that we contribute to? Mexico is quite far away from Strasbourg and experts in Europe particularly. So we have limited resources. How can we best use what we have this year and beyond? Thank you.
No, thank you, Lee. And thank you to all the participants for this last session. I mean, I think it's clear that there's a lot of opportunities where we can work more deeply together. And I mean, I don't know about you, but at one level, this conversation felt fairly unsatisfying. I'm not sure that's even proper English at this point, but because there was so little time to actually engage. And I think one of the things we need to find some time as a MAG to decide is how do we set aside enough time and engage more deeply with a lot of these efforts, and what is the appropriate way to evaluate some of the offers and opportunities that have come forward as well, so that we can move them forward, you know, as appropriate and in a more expeditious manner. But I want to thank everybody for all the effort. And again, you know, at a future MAG meeting, I think we should decide what items are appropriate to come in front of the MAG and how we can best do that so that we actually get some more satisfactory and deeper engagement here. With that, I'd like to move to the last item. In particular, we had requests from a couple of community members that wanted some time to visit a couple of the items that were on the next 2 days meeting, where, of course, those are MAG meetings. It's predominantly and sometimes only MAG members that participate and speak in those meetings. So I think it's important that we actually leave some time to bring up, for them to bring up whatever kind of questions, comments, or suggestions they want to pass on to us for the future. We had that, and then we had a short presentation from Miguel on some working group efforts with respect to new formats. If necessary, I suppose we could always bump that latter one to tomorrow, but I also think that would be a good thing for the open community consultation here to see as well. It is a big piece of trying to further invigorate the IGF. So with that, I see I have Barbara Warner in the queue, and I'm assuming that's to the first item, which is, again, to be clear, there were a couple of comments made that there were some items from the next 2 days agenda that some community members wanted time to comment on here today. So that's what this particular agenda item is at the moment. So Barbara, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My name is Barbara Warner. I'm with the U.S. Council for International Business. We are also active participants in ICC basis. Thank you very much for hearing me today in view of what will be discussed tomorrow. There are two brief comments I wanted to make, one of them concerning the proposal submission process, and also one particular proposal in particular that we submitted. In terms of process, the U.S. Council for International Business has submitted workshop proposals really since 2013. So this will be the fourth time that we've submitted proposals. And that has been an extraordinary learning process with wonderful respect and admiration for the dedication that MAG members put into reviewing these proposals, and also to continuing to consider every year how to improve the workshop proposal process. And I've observed many changes in the proposal process over the years, requirements, priorities, and so forth. This year in particular, I noticed a number of changes, I think, aimed at sharpening the proposals that were submitted, creating more accountability in the proposers to make sure that they were doing proper due diligence in terms of following up with speakers that they are proposing for their various panels. And I appreciate all the effort and thought that went into that. One aspect of that this year did prove to be a bit challenging, and I would just invite the MAG to consider it. It concerned the speaker confirmation element. And in this part of the process, we submitted our workshop proposals, and then the IGF Secretariat automatically generated an email confirmation to the speakers that we had indicated would be participating in our workshops. And for some of the speakers, it was confusing what that email meant. That was despite my concerted effort through emails and telephone calls to clarify that and urge them to respond to that email. In other instances, I think speakers are just very, very busy, have an inbox that's bulging with emails and maybe just got lost in the email. And then in other cases, I think, and especially perhaps for some of our potential government speakers, they just felt uncomfortable offering a commitment this early in the process. So that, as I say, I just invite the MAG to consider that that was a challenging element in submitting workshop proposals this year and to consider how you might weight that differently. Just because a potential speaker did not respond does not mean they are not interested, in other words. The second element was a proposal that we submitted, and here I would just like to express my gratitude and appreciation for the MAG support. It goes to an issue that was a subject of some best practice work that Jack talked about earlier today. It is an item, an SDG, that we want to see implemented and a key element of the WSIS outcome document, and that concerns bridging the gender digital gap. I am delighted that the MAG seemed to appreciate the hard work and thought that went into our proposal and the extraordinary group of women who will be participating in my workshop. And so I just wanted to offer the MAG my heartfelt gratitude for your support for my proposal. Thank you.
Thank you, Barbara. Some key points, and I think we will be considering the speaker identification process for next year's process. Next in the queue, we have Laurie Shulman. Laurie, you have the floor.
Thank you. I want to echo Barbara's comment about the confirmation, and thank you for recognizing that that was a challenge. We were a first-time proposer, and yes, a learning curve, and we really do appreciate the guidance that was published. We had offered as an alternative to confirm speakers because we have the challenge. Again, we didn't even put names because we didn't want to put any names that we couldn't guarantee a confirmation, so we put speaker profiles, and it's not clear whether or not a profile of the type of speaker would ask would garner any greater weight than not having anything. And so that's just a comment that I share with the evaluation. I would like that to be considered. Secondly, I have a question. Keeping within the spirit of inviting diverse speakers and to the point made by Microsoft earlier about including SMEs and small businesses, I was wondering if there is any funding anticipated were we to reach out to small and emerging companies to participate, to provide speakers on our panel, or if it would be left to the proposer to fund the speakers, which could be challenging if the proposer is a nonprofit or like ourselves an association with limited travel resources for volunteers.
As far as funding goes, from the IGF Secretariat, there's very little funding available there, but I mean, there might be a little bit, but very little. But there are other organizations like ISOC has got its Ambassadors Program, et cetera, which do fund other participants to come to the IGF. I think we're going to try and list some of those on our website so that it's easy access for people to find.
Thank you, Jangadine. Thank you, Laurie. Good comments. We have participant number 126. You have the floor. Is there somebody wanting to speak? They can just raise their hand so we can. So 126, you have the floor.
Many thanks to the chair. And I am Li Yunhan from the Institute of Internet Governance, sponsored by CERNIC. And based on my personal capacity, I would like to share some experience and make our contribution to our IGF. I would like to make three points of comments. The first one is the outreach, because we noticed during the next 2 days, there is a working group on the outreach and the communication of IGF. And we have a suggestion to promote the outreach of IGF, such as, is that possible to enhance the linkage and the cooperation between IGF and local and national and regional IGFs? Maybe we can boost, we can set up a session on the national and the regional IGFs and appointed some MAG members and cooperate with the local host to promote the IGF and improve the literacy of the local literacy of IGF, because according to our experience, actually we are paying attention to promote the Chinese community to participate in IGF, but many other communities in China, they don't know IGF. They don't know what is IGF, and they don't know the IGF can bring them bring what benefits to them. So I think maybe it is a feasible approach, and it also reminds me about the ICANN's e-learn platform. ICANN has an e-learn platform and open to many communities to launch their training programs on the e-learn platform. Maybe we can set up a similar platform on the IGF website to boost more participation in this field. And the second comment is the focused topics, because we noticed this year the MagSec doing a lot of works on the categories of and the tags of the workshop proposals. But we also noticed that there are so many overlapping tags in the categories, such as we can see that there are cybersecurity, security, but I think it's very similar. And there are also have the capacity building and the digital literacy. And another one is the internet governance ecosystem and internet governance and internet ecosystem. But I think the three texts indicate the same topics. If we can deduce the text amount, we can clearly see how many hot issues that we are talking about. And it's according to the past IGF experience, it's very easy to get lost in the hundreds of workshops, and the workshops are categorized by the numbering. So if you propose the workshops in the advance, so you can categorize at the number one and number two. But I think maybe in the future, we can categorize the workshop by the topics, and the attendees can choose which workshops they can participate in. And the third comment is the multi-stakeholder cooperation. And I think, yes, we also noticed that fewer private sectors and technology communities and academia attendees in the recent years. But maybe one reason is that they don't know IGF can bring something to them. Perhaps we can make a survey or a questionnaire between the IGF and to seek for the interest of the attendees. That's all. Thank you for listening.
Thank you. We have two more speakers, Peter Majcik and Sharada Srinivasan, and then I'd like to ask Miguel to walk through the new formats. So, Peter, you have the floor.
Thank you. As you continue your important work over the next couple of days, I just wanted to encourage the MAG to take account of the recent Human Rights Council adoption of the so-called Internet Resolution. Adopted by consensus, the updated text of this renewed resolution, which established in 2012 for the first time that human rights apply online as offline. The new text, I believe, could guide the MAG in shaping the substance of the December IGF. In particular, the resolution promotes taking a human rights-based approach to expanding access to the Internet. It condemns intentional disruptions of connectivity or access to information, including through Internet shutdowns, and condemns also attacks against those exercising their human rights online. In this year of anniversaries of the Human Rights Instruments and of the Human Rights Council, we believe it's appropriate to keep this timely resolution in mind and form the agenda for this year's meeting. And then second, I just want to present also an event that, while not a national or regional initiative, is likely of interest to many in the IGF community, which is RightsCon. RightsCon is one of the leading multi-track program conferences on issues at the intersection of the Internet and human rights. In March of this year, we held our fifth RightsCon in San Francisco, convening more than 1,100 people from 84 countries with more than 150 different sessions that addressed many of the most timely and pressing Internet policy issues facing users at risk around the world. We at Access Now are very pleased to announce that RightsCon 2017 will be held in Brussels, Belgium, from 29 to 31 March. While our call for proposals will be open shortly, we are very interested in helping coordinate a session, workshop, or side event focused on improving the collaborative link between the IGF and RightsCon. And looking at the large amount of IGF proposals related to human rights online, we welcome MAG members or IGF community members to advance what this collaborative link could look like. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Sharada, you have the floor. Sharada's in the room. There you are, up there. Okay. Yes, and now you can.
All right. Okay. Thank you, Madam Chair, for the opportunity. I just wanted to make 2 points. The first was I wanted to echo what's already been said in relation to speaker confirmations. As a first-time workshop proposer, I found that part of the process slightly challenging, especially in terms of communicating with speakers and making them understand as to how this process would work, et cetera. The second thing that I wanted to point out in relation to the process of submissions and something that MAC can consider for future IGFs, especially for first-time proposers and newer entrants of this community. I felt that the participant roster, which was provided as a resource person roster for people to access, was quite difficult for most people to get their wrap their heads around, simply because while there was ability for workshop proposers to pick people from that roster, there was very little information on how we could contact them or talk to them about our project or the workshop that we were proposing outside of that platform on the website itself. I understand that there might be privacy concerns in relation to putting out this information quite publicly, but I do think that if there is, in fact, to be a process that allows for resource persons to sign up, there also ought to be a process that where we can communicate with them outside of just the form interface wherein they are asked to confirm their participation in the workshop. There should be a process of deliberation, usually which is seems standard procedure for creation of a workshop, which at this point in time for first-time proposers is not very accessible given the interface. I also found that some of the email confirmations with the interface were slightly difficult to handle. Sometimes there were double entries, and most times you get 2 emails from the interface. I'm not entirely sure if these are technical considerations, but they're definitely things that made the process slightly more unwieldy and might be something that we want to consider if you want a simpler and smoother process for which is more inclusive of the community. Thank you.
No, thank you. Those were very useful comments. I'd now like to ask Miguel to walk through one of the things the MAG wanted to do based on a lot of comments we'd heard was find a way to I guess, energize the MAG sessions and workshops a little bit more. So the MAG established a working group. Miguel is one of the coordinators of it, and this will play in pretty significantly to our workshop selection discussions over the next couple of days. So Miguel, you have the floor, and thank you and your group for all the work as well.
Thank you, Chair. I don't know if you can hear me. Okay. Well, we have just a little work until this meeting because the most part of it will be after the meeting because we're you'll notice later in the presentation most of the workshops we hope we can get them from the proposals that will not be selected in the following days. Well, the main objectives, as you just said, are exploring new and fresh formats to share projects and views and ideas, also to create new ways to participate during the meetings. And the main point, I think, is attract a broader internal community, and especially youth. You can go to the next. Okay. So we have been exploring two kind of sessions. One is the flash meetings. As you may know, we are thinking about pre-selecting the speakers. We thought it's a good idea to do them during lunch breaks in order to get more people to attend to those flash sessions. So it's a good way to have people going around, and if they saw someone speaking, they maybe get interested in what is he saying. And well, actually, the spot we are thinking about will be the place the host will define for lunch, and the sessions might be from 7 up to 10 minute slots, no more than that. You can go to the next. The speakers, as we thought, there will be up to 24 slots. That's 4 days, one lunch break per day, and 6 slots per hour. So we will have 24 speakers or groups of speakers. It depends on how they manage to fit into the time slots. We hope to find those speakers from the non-selected proposals who can adequate to the format for this format proposal. Also, Internet Society Youth Chapter showed their interest in curating the proposals. Internet Society ambassadors could be another feed, and host volunteers. I know there's a program in Mexico for universities to be for university students to volunteer for the IGF, so maybe they can give some presenters into these sessions, and maybe other programs that might be out there if they want to reach out to get them into the slots. We can speak about it. What we need for the flash sessions, it's a little stage. I was thinking about the villa, but maybe it's not the villa because it's not the same place, as far as I know, from the place where the lunch breaks are going to take place. So I think it's better in the place where the lunch breaks are. We need plugs, projectors, cables, adapters, microphone, sound, and chairs for attendees in order to show the people going around that there will be a presentation there, and they can see it and see the presenters. You can go to the next. That was the selected spot, but that slide is wrong. I think I don't know if the host can clarify where the lunch breaks are going to take place. Just the other one. Well, the other format we've been working is in an unconference. The unconference have this kind of I don't know the word for that. Well, the conferences are held by self-proposed speakers. We thought about having a board where each speaker can write down the names and what are they're going to speak about during the conference. This board would be at the during the morning of the selected day, and conferences would take place on the afternoon that same day. We are thinking about 15-minute slots. I don't know if maybe more can be requested, but I don't have any. I don't think we're going to need more than that. Can go to the next. The speakers, we're thinking about the self-proposed speakers during the morning. It's the format is that. And we should work in encouraging non-selected workshop proposers and also youth to take parts of this. And, well, what we need? The next slide, please. A small or middle room for half a day. Stage, plugs, projectors, cables, adapters, microphone, sound, and a big whiteboard in order to propose. The next room. The next, please. If you have any other ideas on this on sessions, please come to us. We can explore them. Next, please. If you want to volunteer for the working group, and there's the address and stuff. Next, please. Well, that's the timeline. After this meeting, maybe point three and four may be completed, and we can start working on point five, the plan approval. And well, the other, I will share with the whole list this presentation if you want to check the other points. And go. The next one, please. Well, again, if you want to volunteer, there's the address. Thank you.
And Miguel, thank you. And thank you to the working group for all the work as well. I think there's some interesting ideas there. From the relatively little I know about the venue, I think those spaces can be accommodated. I think, obviously, the MAG still needs to go through its workshop proposal selection, but given these are largely self-proposed, community member initiated, I think we can assume that some portion of those might go forward. Again, I'm trying not to get ahead of the MAG meeting tomorrow, but I think at some point, if you can meet with Shengetai and Victor Yolanda and just understand the venue a little bit more and they can understand some of the possible requirements, then that will help us to move that forward should the MAG decide to support flash sessions. And so we are at time, and the interpreters need to be released. I have requests for two more speakers, which if I could request the interpreters to stay for five more minutes, we could get those two speakers in. Otherwise, we could probably do without the interpretation, as it's been pretty much in English all day in any case. Okay. Let's press forward. Renata was in the queue, but she's disappeared from the queue. So I guess it's just the United States.
Thank you, Chair. So I just wanted to say that in light of Miguel's presentation, it's good because it seems to respond to some of the comments that we've had today from the members on new and innovative session formats, and so it's good to hear that. And also, just on a general note, I was heartened to hear Chengetai say that this year has been the most successful year in terms of MEG member evaluations. So I wanted to thank you and congratulate the MEG on doing such an excellent job going into tomorrow and really, really digging in and reading all of the evaluations. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Susan. Herman, did you have a short intervention? That will be the last.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to really support Miguel's proposal here. I would like to ask the Secretariat and the local host to have a serious consideration of this. I know that in Mexico we have strong voices that would might arrive in very last minute, and these sessions are a good channel for those voices to have an opportunity to participate. Groups that might otherwise won't be able to have a platform to express their opinions. It could be a good way to have some space for groups that are not familiar with the IGF procedures. And maybe this might bring some stress to the local host to try to accommodate this, but I think at the end of the day will save a lot of headaches in terms of having pressure from groups that would like to take the floor as we experienced in João Pessoa last year. But I think this could be a good way to give them the space, that room that they need. Thank you.
Thank you, Herman. We're being told we need to leave the premises. Let me just do some very, very quick thank yous. Obviously, thank you to the interpreters, and thank you for staying a bit later. Thank you to the transcribers. Those records are just extremely helpful to many participants. Thank you to the online participants, and I'm just so very sorry for all the difficulties we had getting an appropriate online participation, and I will meet with the Secretariat and see if there's anything we can do to ensure that that's addressed more for tomorrow. I'd like to thank the UN staff here on site, who I think probably disliked having to read out participant number 123 as much as I did, because they've been working very diligently in the background to give everybody a name. So I appreciate that and just want to recognize those efforts as well as the support of all the AV team here. With that, I think the only thing to remind everybody is that you must collect your new passes for tomorrow. If you run into somebody who hasn't collected their new pass here at the end of the day, the same arrangements will be available tomorrow morning, 8:30 to 10, I guess, out to 9 to 10 tomorrow, outside of the front gate, and we are in a different conference room 5. Any final words, my manner? Thank you all very, very much. It was a full agenda, and we pushed through it all. So I thank you. Thank you for a great day.